I'm going to need you guys to be paying really close attention. Because in my 12 years of doing this, 3 years full-time, 9 years part-time, in my 12 years of doing this, I've never prepared for a subject. I've never been overwhelmed on a subject. I've never been like about to pull the hairs out of my ears, like I have for this subject. It's confusing. It's going to rub some people that are religious the wrong way. A lot of us have been taught the wrong things. And so not only did I go with biblical verses, but I also consulted the Spirit, which reveals all things. So I wanted to say that right from the get-go because there's a lot of scenarios. So let's just pray because I need you guys to be interceding while I'm preaching up here. Father, in Jesus' name, I ask you, Lord, to help your humble servant. Let me bring this word, Lord, in a way. Let me convey it in such a way that your people will get it and they will live it for the honor and glory of your name. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. All right. The subject for tonight is called the kingdom of God versus the kingdom of heaven. Kingdom of God versus the kingdom of heaven. If you disagree with anything that I say, if you have any questions with anything that I say, see me afterwards. We eventually in the future when we have our own location, we're going to have a bigger board and a nicer board where, you know, but right now this is what we're going to go with. This is going to be more of a teaching session. And so if you disagree or whatever, I don't want to hear your attitude. Just keep it to yourself. Pray and we'll talk. But I need encouragement in this because it's a very subject. Okay, now, in Genesis 1:1, it talks about that in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. So we talk about the heavens and the earth. In other words, the earth was void, it was dark. Those of you that are taking notes, today is a really good day to take notes. Do it with a piece of paper, do it in your phone, however, write these Bible verses down. It's going to be a night of a lot of Bible verses. And so, everybody in here was born with need on where they're going to be in eternity. Now, we can't quite grasp eternity because eternity never ends. Eternity never ends. And so we live in time, you know, linear. God lives in eternity. He was, he is, and he will be. He's the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. God is God. He created heaven, which is God. And then he created Adam in the likeness of God. So I knew it was going to happen. So the thing I'm trying to teach here real quickly is something happened in Genesis 1:1 where it was dark, God existed, nothing else existed, and he said, let there be light. Genesis 1 and 2, the devil comes into the picture, and there was a pride issue in heaven. How many of you know that the father of pride is Satan? Satan is the father of pride. And so he's also what the Bible talks about in Ephesians, that principalities of darkness in the heavenlies. Not heaven, in the heavenlies. And so a lot of times we get attacks from the spiritual wickedness, evil of the heavenlies. That who is the prince of the air? Satan. So the prince of the air attacks us with thoughts, bad evil thoughts, bad things and whatever. And so heaven is trying to reach us. We're trying to reach heaven, but there's a blockage thing that happens. And so all this is going on because here's why I came up with this subject. Jesus came from heaven to earth to preach about the kingdom of God. But yet pastors love preaching about Jesus, but they don't like preaching about what Jesus taught. You didn't get that. Jesus came from heaven to earth. This might go into two sermons, so FYI. I'm not going to rush. I want you guys to get it, okay? Jesus came from heaven to earth preaching what? Catholic faith? Protestant faith? Jewish faith? If you really want to look at it, his mother was Jew. So, he didn't even brought that up. He came to preach kingdom. Can we say kingdom? So pastors are preaching Jesus, and that's all good, but they're not preaching what Jesus taught. Okay. I got like three people that get it. Okay. So let me see if I go a little further. Now we're gonna get into the kingdom a little bit. So just bear with me. Just bear with me. Afterwards, we can have a. I'll be here till midnight to answer all your questions. But here's the thing. Here's a confusion that we have, because there's some subjects in the Bible that, for example, the rapture. Pastor, is the rapture going to be first? Is there going to be pre-tribulation? In other words, we're going to experience like 3.5 years of persecution, then Jesus is going to come, or we're going to experience all seven post-tribulation, and then Jesus is going to come. That's end-time subject. It's open for interpretation. I am of the revelation that Jesus is going to come in the rapture, pick his church up first, and take us to heaven. Now, what's the rapture? The rapture is a combination that Jesus is going to be in the clouds, and he's not going to touch earth. He's going to meet in the clouds, and the dead in Christ shall rise up and meet him, and then go into heaven. Amen? All right. So some people say, well, Pastor, that's really going to be, we're going to experience 3.5 years. I respect your revelation. I respect your interpretation. I've studied all three. This is the one that I believe in. Because we are in a world right now that I feel that God wants to spare his people. Jesus said, or the Bible says in John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his son Jesus. So just bear with me. I'm going to get to the point where kingdom of heaven, kingdom of God. So from the world, we're supposed to love. We're commanded to love. Love thy neighbor as yourself. We're commanded to love. So Jesus in the four Gospels, what are the four Gospels? We're teaching Bible here, so get this. The four Gospels are Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. The four Gospels. What's the Torah? It's the first five books of the Bible. Genesis, Exodus, and so on. So, but right now, the four Gospels right here, Matt, Mark, Luke, and John. Now, John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world, let me put a little heart, that he loved the world, that he gave his only forgotten son, Jesus. Now, Jesus was talking love, 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 love the world, the people, try to rescue them from hell. But from the world, Jesus got his church. And that's where the epistles of Paul, Apostle Paul, comes into the picture. So that's why sometimes you hear people say, don't judge me. Don't judge me is for the world. Jesus said, hey, anybody that wants to throw a stone to this woman, here, throw the first rock. He's talking to the world. We are called to judge, but here we are. We're called to judge in love, and we're called to judge righteously. The rest of the Bible, from the next book, Acts, on, is about for the church. Okay. Am I making sense so far? Okay. So now, with saying all that, to say this, because this is deep stuff right here. We got in the Bible, Matthew, that I took him out, Matthew says 33 times in the Bible, Luke, and Matthew says 33 times in the Bible, kingdom of heaven. Matthew says that. Mark and Luke use instead kingdom of God. That's why you look into the Matthew 3:3. Matthew says, or the book says, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near. Okay? But Mark and Luke say, repent, for the kingdom of God is near. So I went crazy with that. Because obviously they're spelled differently. They have similarities, but they're not the same thing. However, get this clear. In the way that Matthew, Mark, and Luke were talking about it, it is the same thing. Go with me real quickly. But before we go, I want to break this down. 2 Timothy 2:15. 2 Timothy 2:15. I'm going to go real quick with this because there's a lot of, like I mentioned, a lot of things in the Bible that, and this is one of them that people get confused about. Also, the law versus grace. So up here is heaven. Not the kingdom of heaven. Heaven. In other words, this is a place where God resides. Jesus is at the right-hand side of the Father, and his angels saying, holy, 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 hallelujah, and whatnot. The kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven, heaven. 2 Timothy 2:15 says, be diligent to present yourself approved to God, because what I really don't want tonight is to misrepresent God in any way. I want to preach the word that I really don't care that people talk bad about me. I can deal with that. I can't deal with people talking that I misrepresented them. Does that make sense? I don't want to go there. I want to study myself so that I can bring a word that's going to help you guys out. And so, be diligent to present yourself approved to God, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. In other words, all this is truth, but how do you break it down? You can give me an amen every now and then just to help me feel like I'm here. So, kingdom. Now we want to talk about the kingdom. What's a kingdom? According to the kingdom, the definition that I got there is the domain of a king. God's authority and ruler. Who's our king? Amen. So, God is a spirit, and his kingdom is run from heaven to earth. All right? You're with me so far? In other words, it's not a democracy. You know, people voted for Trump that's going to be elected tomorrow, but it's going to be a president tomorrow, but we did not vote for the kingdom and its king, who's Jesus. In other words, what he says must go. In other words, is a government. It's a government, and this government in heaven is about order. Order. Now, stay with me. It's about order. The Bible is about a government, because if there's no governor, if there's no order, there's chaos. And that's why people are disorganized, because there's this order. It's all about the king, Jesus, and his kingdom. Amen? Amen. 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 Now, what's heaven? Heaven, I want you to say with me, is a place. Amen. It's a place. Heaven is a place where God, Jesus, and divine beings originate. In other words, heaven right here is a place. It's a place. Now, people think that when we die, hear me closely, people think that when we die, we go straight to heaven. Let me explain this in less than a minute. The Bible says heaven has what's called Abraham's bosom, Abe's bosom, or in other words for that is paradise. Like when Jesus told the thief, tonight you'll be with me in paradise. So what's paradise? It's not quite heaven. It's a holding area for the spirits of those that lived for God or accepted Jesus or were with Jesus on earth. But the dead, your mom, your dad, or unfortunately your uncle, your great-great-grandmother, they are, their bodies, they're from dust they were created, from dust they shall go. Their bones are in the ground. The Bible says the dead in Christ shall rise when the rapture comes. The rapture hasn't happened. Amen? You're with me so far. So, we don't go to heaven when we die. Our spirit goes to heaven. Our body stays on earth. No, que mi abuela Panchita is looking out for me. No, she's not. Tu abuela Panchita está durmiendo, rest with peace. Déjala tranquila. So, the thing about it is, who's looking out for you is God's guardian angel. Ferocious, mighty angel. Amen. Now, in heaven, there's a kingdom. In other words, a form of government that's run. And that kingdom has authority. What's authority? The angels. You have an assigned guardian angel on your behalf. And so you have angels that are millions and millions and millions. But one third of the angels, unfortunately, went down to earth with Lucifer, the worship leader of heaven at that time. But because of his pride, a lot of people talk about fornication, but they don't talk about pride. But because of his pride, he... God kicked him out. And the Bible talks about that he kicked him out like a lightning. Lightning is like... Like Jesus didn't have to like... It was like, you know, oh, you want to play with me that? No. Like that quick. So we do not go to heaven right away. We go, we stay here, but eventually we are in paradise. So the kingdom of heaven is that. Heaven is a place, in other words, it's temporary. But now here's the thing. The Bible, let's say right now the rapture happens. This is, if you want the series, the three-hour series, the three-part series, three 1-hour sessions of the rapture and the end times and all that, there's a DVD back there. But the rapture, it says the dead in Christ shall rise up, and then they shall join Jesus and go to heaven. When we're in heaven, just real quickly, we're only supposed to be there 7 years. According to the Bible. 7 years. What's going to happen in those 7 years in heaven? We're going to have the wedding feast. It's going to be tremenda fiesta in heaven for those that receive Jesus. 7 years in heaven, while down here is going to be all hell break loose. It's going to be, if you think ISIS is going to be choir boys compared to what's coming. So it's going to be 7 years of tribulation here on earth. You better get ready for what's coming, because it's coming. So now, hell, of course, I'm not going to even mention hell because it's not even worth it, because the Satan is already under my feet. I'm not going to even bother. Not even worth mentioning. To save some time, let's just say that hell is not a nice place. It's considered a place of torment and the gnashing of teeth. What's that? What does that mean? Thank you, Mom. Appreciate it. And so anyway, it's all that. All right? So you got me so far. All righty. So now I'm going to break this down a little further. You guys are with me? You guys are with me? All right. All right. My mom's my biggest cheerleader. I love it. Now, 1 Chronicles 29:11, before we start getting into real... 1 Chronicles 29:11. Getting all messed up here. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness, the power and the glory, the victory and the majesty... For all that is in heaven, not the kingdom of heaven, all that is in heaven is what? And in earth is yours. Is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted as head over all. Colossians 1:16. For by him, who him? God. For by him, God, all things were created. In heaven and on earth. In other words, the invisible and the visible. All things were created by who? By God. Were thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created through him and for him. Now, with that said, let me mention this. The kingdom of God. The kingdom of heaven is mentioned 33 times. I think it's 33 times, 33. By Matthew, that's it, Matthew only. But the kingdom of God is mentioned 70 times. So I started doing some research, mega research on this, on why are there some difference here? And this is where I want to go, Romans 14, 17. And in fact, I want to read this together with you, if it's okay. Because what do we say heaven was a what? A place, right? In other words, physical. You got it? Physical. The kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven are not heaven. Amen. I'm shocking some of you right now. Heaven is not the kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven. Heaven is right here. God, the kingdom of God. Now, but let's read it for the word. I don't want you guys taking me for my face value. Romans 14, 17. You have it? Is it up there? Okay. Let's read it together. You ready? 1, 2, 3. For the kingdom of God is not eating and drinking, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. In other words, it's righteousness. What's righteousness? Right standing. In other words, the king's standard. Well, pastor, you're supposed to love people. Yes, I'm supposed to love people, but I'm also supposed to share God's standards with them. Amen? So, in other words, it says righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. Righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit is what? The kingdom of God. What is the kingdom of God? Romans 14, 17. For the kingdom of God is not eating and drinking. In other words, it's not physical. It's righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. Amen? So here's the thing. You may squeak into heaven, but if you're not in right standing with God, you may squeak into heaven, but if you're not putting God first in your life, like Matthew 6:33 says, seek first, what? The kingdom of God, and it's what? Righteousness. And then everything that I have in heaven will be given to you. Some of you are going to squeak into heaven by a toenail. But you're not going to have righteousness, peace, and love in the Holy Spirit. Or joy in the Holy Spirit. So you're doing yourself a disservice. Luke 17, 20. Now when he asked the Pharisees, I'm going to read real quick. When the kingdom of God will come, he answered them and said, the kingdom of God does not come with observation. In other words, you can't see it. Nor will they say, see here or see there. For indeed, the kingdom of God is within who?
You.
Amen. Amen. So here's the thing. Here's the kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven. Righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. How everything began. You know that. So you know how everything rolled before. It was the Old Testament for the Jews, which was the law. Okay, for those of you that want to understand the Bible real quickly, you probably don't have to read it for at least 2 months. Just here's right here, a simple nutshell. So, the Old Testament, the law, then comes Jesus. New Testament. 39 books here, 27 books here. New Testament. Bible says in order to have remission, atonement for your sins, there needs to be shedding of blood. Jesus shed his love, his blood for the world. And then now that blood is a gift for you to receive, you who? The body of Christ. Am I making sense? All right. So, this was prior to Jesus. Now, we're not under the new Old Testament. Now, we are under grace. the new covenant. Old covenant, new covenant. Makes sense. All right. So now, while all that was going on, when grace came into the picture, all of a sudden what happened? The church began. The church. Then Apostle Paul. But here's where I want to go with this. Apostle Paul. Now, the Jews, the Israel, thought that Jesus was going to come somewhere around here. But he never did. Jesus, now, I mentioned how many years we're going to be in heaven?
Seven.
So in other words, when you die, or the rapture comes, one or the other, and if you are in Christ, you receive Jesus, you're going to be in heaven 7 years. After that, there's going to be something else happening over here. And I read that in Revelation 21. Revelation 21. Before we go there, put what the kingdom of heaven is. The kingdom of heaven is a sovereign kingdom. Kingdom of heaven. Okay, the kingdom of heaven is a sovereign kingdom where we who? The body of Christ, where we shall reign. In other words, it's a literal government of heaven over the earth. It's a literal government of heaven over the earth. So Jesus came, shed his blood, the body of Christ, the church began, not the Catholic Church like some people think, like, oh, because Jesus told in his ministry over here, in his 33 years of living, Jesus told Peter, on you I shall form my church, the rock. You will be Peter, and flesh and blood didn't reveal that to you. And then all of a sudden, like 500 years later, the Catholic Church comes into the picture, and people think that God, that Jesus was talking to them. No, it's not. That's a lie. Okay, let's make that clear. That was popes getting together and forming a religion. But the thing about it is, the church is not the Catholic Church. The church is the body of Christ. Amen. Give God a clap offering for that. Amen. So that's what the kingdom of heaven is. In other words, flesh and blood cannot get you to heaven. Flesh and blood cannot have it. What will get you to heaven? I'm glad you asked. John 3:3. John 3:3. Jesus answered and said to him, Nicodemus, most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born again, in other words, we're born first in the physical. Unless one is born again, what do you mean by born again? I'm talking about the other one-third of you, your spirit. Hallelujah. He cannot see the kingdom of God. Is he talking about heaven? He's talking about the kingdom of God. It's in us. In other words, help me, Lord. You can have heaven. You can squeak into heaven and live like hell here on earth. Because you don't have righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. You guys all right with me? I know I'm going to lose some friends over this. Oh, well. But the Bible says it's a government. The Bible even talks about it, I believe in Isaiah, that the government shall rest in his shoulders. Jesus. In other words, it's a theocratic government that God will set up on earth. Jesus is the king. That's why he says, thy kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. Let me read to you this right here, because this is in Revelation 21:4. You ready? In other words, it's not a visible kingdom yet. Can we say yet?
Yes.
I want you to say with me, the kingdom of heaven,
is a
future, futuristic kingdom. In other words, it's a millennial versus universal. The kingdom of heaven is not referring to the third heaven, meaning heaven where God is right now. Let me read so you can understand a little better. Now I saw a new heaven. This is John, Apostle John. He says, now I saw a new heaven. In other words, it's not this heaven. You following me? It's not this heaven. There's a new heaven. So there's something that's going to be happening over here, because what happens after the 7 years that we're in heaven? What happens then? We come to earth with a new heaven, like I'm about to read to you. I lost a lot of ear hairs with this preparation, trust me. New heavens and new earth, where we're going to be communicating with heaven in itself on earth. It's going to be a new heaven. It says, "And then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no more sea. Then I, John," disciple John, "saw the holy city, New Jerusalem." This is where the Jews are going to receive this. They will receive this king who will be Jesus Christ descending from heaven and coming down, being the King of kings and Lord of lords, and us all who are in Christ being rulers with him. I'm excited for that. I'm excited. Coming down, the New Jerusalem coming down, in other words, pretend it's a city, the new heaven coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from heaven, not the kingdom of God or the kingdom of heaven, from heaven, saying, "Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them," he who, Jesus, "and they shall be his people. God himself will be with them," in other words, Jesus, because he's God, "and be their God." Number four, "And God will wipe away every tear." Thank you, Jesus. A lot of people are suffering here. "God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, no more sorrow, no more crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away." Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So, to finish my point on kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of heaven is the kingdom from heaven. Like I read here, it's a kingdom from heaven coming down to earth. It's a kingdom from heaven, not a kingdom in heaven. Does that make sense? It's not in heaven, but it's coming from heaven. That's the kingdom of God. But yet, Mark, Matthew, and Luke all meant the same thing when they were talking about the kingdom of God: righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. Amen? Daniel 2:44. "And in those days, in the days of these kings of God of heaven, will set up a kingdom that we shall not be destroyed," never be destroyed, "and the kingdom shall not be left to other people. It shall break in pieces and consume all these kingdoms, and it shall stand forever." In other words, Jesus came first as a lamb, but then he's going to come as a lion. He came as the Lamb of God. Now he's going to come as the Lion of Judah. He came with love. The next time he's going to come, arrahatabla, because he's going to be the judge. Now, there's Bible verses that say not everyone that says, "Lord, Lord," shall enter the kingdom of heaven and whatnot. "Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." Even Jesus replied to John, Pontius Pilate, "My kingdom is not from this world." Because he was already seeing the futuristic kingdom that he was going to bring. So even Jesus knew that's why Pontius Pilate couldn't understand him. Because Jesus was talking about a different type of kingdom. Like John the Baptist, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is here." Or later mentioned, "For the kingdom of God is here." So here's my question boiling down to all this. Is the kingdom of heaven and the kingdom of God the same thing? Well, they are both right in a way, but not right at the same time. Okay? They're both right in a way. They have similarities, but similarities doesn't mean they're the same. They're similar, but they're not the same. So they're not the same. Now, this breaks it down even better. What time we got? Okay, we're doing good. You let me know when some of you are tuning out, just do this, okay? Matthew 19:23, Matthew uses both. Look what Matthew 19:23 says. Then Jesus said to his disciples, this is Matthew who wrote this, "Assuredly I say to you that it is hard for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven." Verse 24. "And again I say to you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God." So which one is it? He uses both in the same time. There's no significant difference. They're the same thing. The reason why I believe Matthew did not use kingdom of God and he used kingdom of heaven is because Matthew was sensitive to the Jews, because God is a sacred name, but heaven is not that sacred. And so he wanted to be kind of like politically correct. He kind of like didn't want to offend them, okay? He wanted to be cool with them. He wanted to just keep them, you know, right there in the forefront. So they're basically the same thing, kingdom of heaven, kingdom of God. The kingdom belongs to God, the one who is God in heaven, the physical place above and beyond everything. Now, what does all this, Pastor, has anything to do with me? What does all this, Pastor, has to do with peace and joy? Can you check the AC, or is it me? It's cold? Okay, it's me then. What does all this mean, Pastor? What does all this mean? Now, the way I was raised, they talked about the kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven as heaven, but it's not. Especially in some people, there are some pastors that believe that they're both pointing to this one, but it's not. I've already proven to you with biblical scripture. It's not the same thing. So let's read what's required for salvation. What's required for salvation? How many of you want to make it to heaven for those 7 years? How many of you later want to have dwelling, being a ruler with Jesus Christ in the new heavens and the new earth? Okay, what is required of you? Romans 10:9. That if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Well, Pastor, does that mean that my struggling uncle who gave his life to Jesus, believed Jesus, confessed with his mouth, believed with his heart, he left booze for 6 months, went back at it for 6 years, went out of booze again, he's going back and forth. Well, that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. I don't see no conditions there. I read further, verse 10. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness. Remember the famous verse in Romans? What's the kingdom of God? Righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. Let's say it together. Righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. Righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. So it says, for with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. So can the fornicator, like I was 10, 15 years ago, I love Jesus. He's my father. I'm his son. But I have a problem with my flesh. I can't control it. Will I make it to heaven according to my Bible? Yes. But will you have righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit? Absolutely not. Because that's the kingdom of God. Remember what I read. You got to write that verse down. That verse is in Romans 14:17. You got to remember that verse. That verse talks about what is the kingdom of God. I go a little further, if I may. Because we have to understand that when I was in my struggling flesh, I was still a son of God. I wasn't going to hell like I was taught that like, you've been great for 60 years, but now you're cheating on your wife, you're going to hell. No, you're not going to have the kingdom of God, but you've already confessed Jesus. So you're not going to have righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit, but you're going to have heaven. But you're not going to have the kingdom of God. Two different things. Amen? So salvation is eternity. Salvation is God's gift. Can we say gift?
Gift.
To those who believe in their heart and confess with their mouth, like I just read in Romans 10. In other words, no conditions required. The moment, here is what I want you guys to understand this. Because we're not supposed to judge who's going to heaven. You're not going to have the kingdom of God, righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. You're not going to have, the kingdom of heaven is a futuristic thing. But you're not going to have righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. But you're going to have heaven. But this is what I want you to get. The moment we start putting conditions on salvation, which according to the Word says, if you confess with your mouth, who gives salvation? It's God. The moment we as humans put conditions on salvation, it no longer belongs to God. It belongs to you. And that ain't biblical. You haven't given no gift to nobody. You haven't shed any blood for nobody. So salvation, heaven is yours, but you're not going to have peace. I don't want to have heaven and live like hell here on earth. I want it all. I want peace, joy, and righteousness in the Holy Spirit. Amen. And this is why I try to tell people that we do not judge who goes to heaven. We can judge, hey, you're committing adultery. You're cheating on your wife. That's not right. You won't have the kingdom of God, of peace, love, of peace, joy, and righteousness in the Holy Spirit. But, you know, who am I? The gift was given by God. The moment it becomes conditional, then it's your gift, and it's not your gift, it's God's gift. I'm going to read to you the Bible verse, Ephesians 2:8. For by grace you have been saved through what? Faith. And that not of yourselves. In other words, you didn't earn it. You didn't work for it. You didn't knock in doors trying to save people. You didn't live holy, holy, holy. I'm not talking about you having heaven. You're going to get heaven. I'm talking about you having kingdom of God in you. But it's a gift. It says, through faith and not of yourselves. You can't earn it. Why? Because it is the gift of God. Not of works, lest anyone should brag. For we are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared before him, and that we should walk in them. In other words, Jesus didn't come for church members. He came for kingdom members. Amen. Amen. But, in other words, God took salvation, hear me closely, God took salvation from your hands, because you're not in charge of who goes to heaven, who goes to hell. That's not your job. God took salvation out of your hands and put it into his hands. It's the gift of God to give you. Now, here's the thing. What you decide to do with that gift is yours. What you decide to do with that gift that Jesus gave you is yours. Do you want righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost? Then you got to do what the King and his protocol and the kingdom of heaven, kingdom of God, have already placed, the standards of God that are there for you to have peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. Otherwise, you're going to live in bondage, captivity. You're going to live unfulfilled. You're going to live empty. You're going to live with a void. You're not going to maximize on your potential. You're going to not have right expectations. You're not going to live with purpose. You're not going to have plans. Let me tell you, show you what I mean real quick. I mean, this is what's going to happen when you don't have the kingdom of God in you. We have these two Christian brothers. One of them is fleshly. One of them is somewhat spiritual. And then I'm the spiritual one, so I'm not going to get handcuffed. But this one, before you handcuff the brothers, the gifts of the Spirit are peace, love, self-control, all those. But the gifts of the, not the gifts, but the flesh. No, the fruits of the Spirit are peace, love, joy, gentleness, self-control. But the works of the flesh, are adultery, fornication, getting drunk, denying God, gossiping, all that stuff is works of the flesh. So before you start pointing fingers to, oh, look at that one over there, he's sleeping with that woman, you can go and say, hey, brother, you know, that's not going to get you the kingdom of God, which is peace, joy, and righteousness in the Holy Ghost. But here's the thing. Well, some of you are gonna probably need to lay off some wine because you're in drunkenness. But this is what happens. Cuff the brother up real quick. Yep, and in the front. Oh, in the legs, okay. This guy, make sure you have the keys. So here's what happens when we have heaven, but not the kingdom of heaven, not the kingdom of God in us. Try to walk over here, brother. Okay, he's walking, but he's a little, you can come back. He's walking, he doesn't have quite the balance that he usually has, but he's walking. I need you to pay attention. Don't interrupt me, because I got to make my point here real quick. He is struggling because he is in bondage. He is in captivity. You know, yes, there's a lot of Bible verses out there that says those that sin deliberately, there's no sacrifice for sins. Yes, there's Bible verses out there that says, work your salvation. In other words, you have it, now work it so you will have the kingdom of God, peace, joy, and righteousness in the Holy Ghost. But now you got to work that. You've been given the gift. What are you going to do with this gift is up to you. But the Bible says you got to work it. You got it. Now work it. Work it means serve, you know, get better, grow in wisdom, grow in knowledge. You know, that's if you want. But if you're not abiding by the standards of the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, handcuff the other brother. This one is really a serious drunk. He's a bad mouth. He's a liar. I can just like slap him. He won't do nothing to me because he doesn't have any power. He doesn't have any authority. He's in captivity. But you did receive Jesus as your Savior. You did receive Jesus as your Savior. Did you confess with your mouth? Did you confess with your mouth? Did you believe in your heart? Okay, so supposedly salvation is yours. Heaven is yours. But you don't have the kingdom of God. Because how could you walk in peace when you're in bondage? How could you defeat the army of the devil? How could you how could you handle the attacks of the enemy when you can't fight back? Because the kingdom of God is not in you. Amen? Do you get it? So I want you to keep him for the remainder of the service with this. But the kingdom of God is not in them. Because, listen, when you're addicted to drugs, alcohol, when you're at pornography, lust, when you have fear that overrun the works of the flesh, when you have, you cannot have peace and joy and righteousness. Righteousness means you're in right standing. God can't see you as righteous. You're righteous because of Jesus, but now you're not walking in the kingdom of God. So now what happens? You're in bondage. I haven't met one person that has the peace of God, that has joy unspeakable, that are living in captivity. The kingdom of God is not with them. They might squeeze by a toenail into heaven, but they're not going to have heaven on earth. They're not going to have the kingdom of God in them. God bless them. Give them a clap offering. So to finish up, because I want to finish this. Now, what I'm talking about here tonight is not about being saved. I'm talking about having the kingdom of God in you. I want the kingdom of God in you. And Galatians 5:19, to wrap it up. Galatians 5:19. Put it up in the board real quick. What are the works of the flesh? The ones that keep you out of the... notice what it says. Now, the works of the flesh are evident, which are adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lewdness. Go on. Idolatry, sorcery, in other words, consulting with like Harry Potter type of stuff, horoscopes, hatred, contentions. There's people that are Christians and jealousies, outburst of wrath, selfish ambitions, dissensions, heresies. Go on. Envy, murders, drunkenness, revelries, and the like, of which I tell you beforehand, just as I also told you the time past, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Peace, joy, righteousness in the Holy Ghost. It doesn't say heaven. We already talked about what heaven is. If you confess with your mouth, believe in your heart. I mean, really believe. Now, next verse. Let me tell you about the fruits of the Spirit. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness and faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. And those who are in Christ have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. It doesn't talk about heaven. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Some of you will walk in the flesh. I walk in the flesh sometimes. Sometimes I catch myself. I go, I'm walking in the flesh again. Father, help me. Or am I the only one that struggles with walking in the flesh? Oh, okay, okay. How many of you don't have no struggles with the flesh? Okay, good. I'm glad. We're going to pray for you. But so, again, these things. But here's the thing. And one more Bible verse, if I may. Can I get five more minutes? Can I get five more minutes? 1 Corinthians 6:12. You got to get this. This is the final Bible verse. All things are lawful for me. In other words, do what you want. God's not going to stop you. If you want to follow your flesh, do what you want. But all things are not helpful. In other words, you can do it and still be a Christian and make it to heaven. But get ready for the consequences and the penalty. Because one day you think, oh, you know what? Let me go cheat on my wife. Let me go cheat on my husband. Let me go smoke that weed. Let me go smoke that cigarette. Let me go have that, you know, if I have a struggle with alcohol, let me just have alcohol one more time, even though 3 years ago I was a drunk. You may think you have it. And then you turn around one day and without even knowing it, it has you. So you got to understand that you are free to choose, according to 1 Corinthians 6:12 over here, you're free to choose and choose to do whatever you surrender to. But you are not free. You are not free from the consequences of that choice. You may squeak into heaven, but you're not going to have heaven on earth. Today's complacency, you being complacent with the Word of God, you don't want to do this like the way the King of Kings in his kingdom says you shall live. Today's complacency can be and will be tomorrow's captivity if you're not careful. Amen? So when this Bible verse that I broke down, the moment you called unto him, Jesus, I'm closing. The moment you called unto him, Jesus, you no longer belong to you. The moment you called unto Jesus, you no longer belong to you. You belong to Jesus. You're saved. You don't belong to you anymore. When you want to live a little bit for Jesus and a little bit for you, you're conflicted. You're double-minded. You're unstable in all your ways. You don't have the kingdom of God, peace, joy, and the righteousness and the Holy Ghost. And so, this is not for heaven, even though you need heaven, but this is for you to have the kingdom of God, peace that surpasses all understanding, joy that's unspeakable, and the righteousness of God, right standing, that God will see you and bless you accordingly. Because of your right standing. With all head bowed and eyes closed. Thank you, Jesus. Don't be contradicted. Thank you for joining us. I pray and hope that tonight's message was well rooted in your soul. You know, this ministry has been given a God-given vision for our community right here in Miami. It's a vision that's going to be called Rise Up Outreach Center. That's going to be helping teens with their teenage issues. It's going to be helping relationships that are struggling, people that are struggling with addictions, all kinds of scenario. For more information, just visit our website right now. But what we need is your support for this vision. This vision is going to be costly. It's going to take a lot of manpower. It's going to require a lot of resources. And you know what? We need you. The gospel is free. But in order to advance it, requires resources. The kingdom of God, in order to be impacted further, requires people to step up and give, requires people to step up and work. The information to give is right there on your screen. You can also go to the website under donate and give through that channel as well. Thank you for your support. God bless you, and I'll see you next Thursday.